Hello friends, welcome to my channel. So in this video we will take NMR studies in metal clusters. So NMR studies include proton NMR, carbon 13 NMR, phosphorus 31 NMR, fluorine 19, and we will take rhodium 103. So these four type of NMR studies are important in case of metal clusters. So I am not going in detail of NMR, what is NMR and how we can calculate chemical shifts, etc. I am just talking about NMR studies in metal clusters, what are the different type of protons and their chemical environment, and how chemical shift is affected in metal clusters, and how we can solve problems from CSIR NET and GATE. In proton NMR, H1, I is 1 by 2. Similarly, it is 1 by 2 for carbon 13, for phosphorus 31, fluorine 19 and rhodium 103. Rhodium is also NMR active. Therefore, you have to consider rhodium if they are present in the cluster. So, in case of NMR, we are determining chemical shift with respect to TMS. We all know that we are calculating with respect to TMS peak. This is tetramethylsilane peak, suppose. This one, okay, and it has very high intensity. So in case of organic compound, we are considering this range 0 to 15 ppm. The chemical shift is denoted in form of delta and it is measured in ppm. So 0 to 15 ppm range is used for hydrogens associated with organic molecules. Okay, this is about proton NMR. And if we are considering protons present in metal clusters, or they are directly attached to the metals or in the influence of metal, then we will get peak in minus range from 0 to minus 60 ppm. Okay. And we are using proton NMR for the metal clusters which having MH bond, in which hydrogens are present. In the compounds in which we do not have any hydrogen, we cannot use proton NMR. We will use carbon 13 and phosphorus NMR. So in case of MH, why we are using NMR, why we cannot use IR studies, as we have studied in previous video, that to determine CO stretching, we can use IR. So for the CO stretching, we have IR frequency in range of 2100 to 1600 centimeter inverse. And MH stretching is also lies in this region. And this intensity is very weak. The stretching frequency of MH vibration is very weak as compared to CH stretching. So we cannot determine the presence of MH if we have CO present in a cluster. So this IR study is not useful in case of metal hydride containing clusters. So it is not useful. We will use this proton NMR studies. So let's take an example here. We have this complex, and in this complex we have this cyclopentadienyl ring. It is eta 5. Its hepaticity is eta 5, and for this one we have hepaticity 1 because it is connected with this carbon. So hepaticity is 1, and in this case we have these 5 protons. Okay, and if you see carefully and you have knowledge about NMR studies, then you can easily find out that this proton is in the direct influence of this metal. Therefore, it is chemically different than these two. So we can write HA here and HB for them, these two. So these two are equal in chemical environment, and this one is different, and these two are also different because these two are close to iron but these are far away. So I can write like this. So we have 5 different type of hydrogen in this ring, while for this ring its hepaticity is eta 5, means all the hydrogens are in equal environment. These all are equal. Okay, so if you have cyclopentadienyl ring, then you will get proton NMR peak in range of 4.825 ppm. okay, and for this type of hydrogen which is close to this iron, its delta value will be negative, and it is generally from minus 7 to minus 60 ppm. So its value is in the negative range. Then why we have this hydrogen in the shielded region? This minus value indicates that it is in the shielded region. This region, if you remember, this is the shielded region of NMR. And if you go on the this side, then your protons are deshielded. So you are further moving to the right side of this axis. So these all protons lies in this region, all are highly shielded. So why they are shielded? If you compare metal hydrogen bond, then electronegativity of hydrogen is much higher than metal. So if a metal is directly attached with hydrogen, then electron will be pulled towards the hydrogen, and this hydrogen has a delta negative charge, while this metal has delta positive charge. Means all the electrons density is pulled towards the proton, and if there is higher electron density, then it will be in the shielded region. So for this compound, you will get a single peak for these 5 hydrogens, and intensity is high because it is because of 5 hydrogens, and you will get 3 peaks due to this ring in the ratio of 2 is to 1, because we have these 2 hydrogen are of same type, these 2 are of same type, and this one is of different type. So you will get 4 different peaks in the NMR study of this complex, because we have this one lies in the 4.8 to 5 range, this one is in the highly shielded region, they will be little bit deshielded, and they will more deshielded to these two. So we have 4 peaks for this compound, but you will get these 4 peaks when you are recording NMR at low temperature. Means suppose you are recording at minus 60 degree centigrade, then you will get 4 different peaks. If you are recording at room temperature, means nearly at 28 degree centigrade, then you will get single peak, a peak like this. This peak has higher intensity because it is because of 10 hydrogens, 5 of this one and 5 of this one. So you have a single peak at room temperature. But if you are recording at minus 20 degree centigrade, then you will get 2 peaks, one due to these 5 and one due to these 5. Why you are getting a single peak because of this? Because these all hydrogens can exchange with each other at higher temperatures. Okay, so they are in the similar environment at higher temperature, and you will get a single peak for all of them. This process is called as ring whizzing. These hydrogens can exchange their positions at higher temperature, so you will get a single peak for all of them. But if you are lowering down or you are cooling the mixture, then you will get 4 different peaks. Okay, now the ring whizzing is completely stopped. They cannot exchange their positions. They are locked at their position. You can consider that. And you will get 3 different peaks because of these 5 hydrogens, and single peak for these 5 hydrogens. Next, we have this an example, and we want to find out its IR and NMR peaks. So for these 5 hydrogens, we have single peak. One peak due to these 5 hydrogens, and they will lie in the range of nearly 5 ppm. Then for these 3 hydrogens, it is not directly influenced by this metal. So for these 3 hydrogens, we will get one peak, and it will lies in the range of 2.5 to 3.5 ppm. Okay, and for the IR studies, you will get 2 IR peaks. One is due to these 2 CO and it will lie in the range of 2120 to 1850. These are terminal carbonyls. So for the terminal like carbonyls, we have the this range of IR peaks. And for this carbonyl, you will get a peak at 1680 centimeter inverse. So in this way, you can identify what is your compound. Next, we move to carbon 13 NMR. So mostly we studied carbon 13 NMR for the carbonyl compounds which do not have any hydrogen. So for this type of compound, you will get a single peak in carbon 13 NMR because all the four carbonyls are in the similar environment. Similarly, for these five carbonyls, you will get single peak. Okay, and you know that they can exchange their position, which is known as fluxionality. So if you want to find out that which CO can exchange their position, then always consider that equatorial CO can exchange their position. This is a question from CSIRnet that they asked you to find out that which CO can exchange their position. So always remember that the CO which are equatorial to each other can exchange their positions. Like this one can exchange with this one, or this one, or this one, or we can exchange this one with this one. Okay, so they can exchange, but axial CO cannot exchange their positions. Then we move to this compound. It will also give you a single peak, and this peak can be splitted because of the presence of these rhodium atoms. So for this carbonyl, suppose you get a peak like this. This is a single peak, but because of the presence of other NMR active nuclei, this peak will get splitted. So how we can determine a splitting? Using this formula, 2ni plus 1. So n is the number of other NMR active nuclei, I is its nuclear spin. So 2 into, we have 3 rhodium atoms, so we will multiply it by 3, and I for rhodium is 1 by 2 plus 1. So we have 4, means this peak will be splitted into 4 peak, and the intensity ratio will be 1 is to 3 is to 1 is to 3 is to 3 is to 1. We know that if a peak is splitted into 2, it will be 1 is to 2. For 3, it will be 1 is to 2 is to 1. For 4, it will be 1 is to 3 is to 3 is to 1. And for 5, 1 is to 4 is to 6 is to 4 is to 1. So in this way, we can determine what will be the intensity of peaks splitted. Then we have a question here. The carbonyl resonance in carbon 13 NMR of this complex shows a triplet at minus 65 degree centigrade, and this triplet is due to. So we have this complex. So first we will try to find out its structure by bonding. So we know that in the complexes which have number of atoms less than or equal to 4, we use this formula, B by 2 is equal to N into 18 minus total valence electrons upon 2, where B by 2 will tell you the total number of metal-metal bond. Okay, so why we are determining metal-metal bond? Because in case of terminal CO, we have different type of bonding, and for the bridging CO, we have different type of peaks. Okay, so for this complex, the value of N is 3. Okay, so we have 18 into 3 minus total valence electron. Total valence electron, 5 for Cp, rhodium 9 and CO2. So we have 16 here into 3 because it is whole thrice. So it will become 48 divided by 2. So we have here 54 minus 48 divided by 2, so it is 3. So total number of metal-metal bonds are 3. Okay, means there are total 3 rhodium-rhodium bonds. Now we want to find out number of metal-metal bonds per atom. So we will take A by N. A is total valence electron, 48 divided by N is 3. So it will become 16. 16 means, you know that 18 minus 16 is 2. Means there are 2 metal-metal bonds per metal. So if you have any doubt how I am calculating all this, you can watch my video on bonding in metal clusters. I will provide the link of that video in the description box, so you can watch it there. So there are total 2 rhodium-rhodium bonds per metal. Means we can have a structure like this, that rhodium, one rhodium bond is like this one, and it can bond with another one. It will also bond with this one. So for this rhodium we have 2 bonds, for this one we also have a 2 bond, and for this one we have 2 bonds, and in total we have 3 bonds. Now we have to place these CP and CO. So suppose I am placing this CP here, this one here, and this one is here. Okay, and we have CO here. Okay, and in case of NMR, carbon 13 NMR, we are getting a triplet at minus 65 degree centigrade. So this triplet means, if we have suppose terminal CO, okay, so this CO means this carbon will interact with only one rhodium. If it is interacting with one rhodium and we have a single peak like this, so when it will interact with one rhodium, this peak will split into 2Ni plus 1, means 2 into 1 into 1 by 2 plus 1, means it should split into 2. So we will get a doublet, not a triplet. And if we have bridging CO like this one, then we have 2N here, 2 into 1 by 2 plus 1, so it will become 3. So we have triplet here. It means we have CO arranged like this. So in this way we have a peak which is, and this single peak is due to these 3 carbonyls, and this peak is further splitted into triplet because of these 2 rhodium, because each CO is associated with 2 rhodium metals, therefore the peak will be split into 3. Suppose we have a bonding like this, the rhodium-rhodium bonds are again 2 and total number of bonds are 3. But I am arranging CO in a different manner. So suppose I have this type of arrangement. Now these 2 CO are bridging in nature and one is terminal. So what will be the type of NMR peaks in this case? For these 2 CO which are bridging in nature, they will interact with these 2 RH. So for each CO, if we are getting one peak, then this peak will be split into triplet because we have 2 rhodium. 2Ni plus 1, so we have 2 into 2 into 1 by 2 plus 1, so each peak is split into triplet. Okay, and for this terminal CO, because it is interacting with only one RH, so its peak will be split into doublet. So we have 2 different types of peak, one is split into triplet and other one is split into doublet. And if you try to find out NMR of this compound, you will get 3 peaks. Why you are getting 3 peaks? Because this CO and this CO is in the different environment. This, for this one, CP is trans, and for this one, it is in the same plane. So it is also interacting with this CP in different manner. So actually you are getting 3 peaks. So here you can see that what is the difference in the NMR pattern of this complex and this complex having same general formula. So the answer of this question is this triplet is due to Bridging's U. Bridging's U. So this is the answer of this question. Next, move on to the carbon 13 NMR shifts in different ligands. So for alkyl, you will get minus 40 to 20. For pi bonded system, you will get 40 to 120. Pi bonded means in case of alkene and cyclopentadienyl rings. So you will get peaks in the range of 40 to 120. For carbonyls, when you have terminal CO, you will get peak in between 150 to 220. For bridging, you will get 230 to 290. For carbenes, it is 200 to 400 ppm. Now we want to take phosphorus 31 NMR. Phosphorus is also tip and its nuclear spin is 1 by 2. So let's take an example. We have Wilkinson catalyst here. So and this proton and this phosphorus NMR is proton decoupled, because means we are not considering that it is interacting with protons present in the molecule. So we try to find out if these phosphorus are in the similar chemical environment or they are in the different. So these two phosphorus are in the similar environment because they have same distance to this Cl and same distance to this one. So we can write AA here, means these two are similar. And this one is different because it is away from or trans to this Cl, so it has different chemical environment. So this one is different, you will get two peaks, one due to these two phosphorus and one due to this phosphorus. Now this rhodium is also IR, this rhodium is also NMR active, so it will also interact with these three phosphorus. So if you want to record peak for these two phosphorus, then this peak will be, this single peak will be splitted due to this phosphorus. Okay, means 2Ni plus 1, it will also split it due to this rhodium. So I can write 2Mi plus 1. Means for Pa, this phosphorus is 1 only. So you will take 2 into 1 into 1 by 2 plus 1. And this rhodium is also 1 in number, so 2 into 1 into 1 by 2 plus 1. So you will have 2 into 2 means 4. So this peak is splitted into 4 peaks. The PA peak will be splitted into 4 peaks. Now we are taking PB peak. So for phosphorus B, the single peak will be split it into due to this rhodium and these two phosphorus. So 2 into 2, because we have 2 phosphorus here, into 1 by 2, its nuclear spin plus 1 into 2 into 1, 1 rhodium, 1 by 2 its nuclear spin and 1. So we have 3 into 2 here. Means it is split into 6 peaks. Okay, so in this way you have to consider the phosphorus interaction with each other and other nuclei if it is NMR active. So now we have another example and we will try to find out number of different chemically different phosphorus. So this phosphorus and this phosphorus are in the different chemical environment because it is close to CO. So it will interact with this one. It is carbon 13 active. So it will interact with this one. So it will be different. And this phosphorus will be in different environment. So we will write PB here. This one is in the totally different environment because it is attached with two methyl groups. So we can write PC here. And this is also different because it is attached with three phenyl rings and these two CH2CH2 groups. So we have four signal for this compound. Okay. Then we will move to question from CSI NET. So this question is from December 2018 and they given you that we have phosphorus 13 proton decoupled NMR spectrum of diamagnetic complex MR MPR3 whole thrice Cl3. Okay, M is a transition metal and its nuclear spin is I is equals to 0, means it is NMR inactive. So you have to find out number of peaks in this complex. So they giving you MR complex. So what should be its structure? MR complex means the group should be like this. So for MR complex we have a structure like this, and if we have facial isomer of it, then the structure will be like this. So this is for facial and this is for MR, and in the examination they asked you about MR isomer. So we will first take this one. So if you look at these three phosphorus, then these two are in the same environment. Okay, and you can consider it like this, that this is a single plane. These are in the plane which is moving inside of your screen. Okay, this one is coming outside and these two are moving inside, and this one and this one are below and above this plane. So this is interacting with all these four and this one is also interacting with all these four. So they are in chemically same environment. This one is in different environment because it has different bonding with these three Cl and these two Pr. So we have two different type of phosphorus here. So we will get two peaks. Next we move to next question. This question is from June 18. The question is not visible, so I am writing here. So we have this question. This complex is first reacting with methyl iodide and it will give you A. And the NMR spectrum of NMR of this complex A has two peaks in 3 to 5 intensity. Then this A complex is reacting with PPH3 and it will give you B. And in the B we have 3 NMR peaks, proton NMR peaks, and they are in the ratio of 3:5:15. So you have to find out A and B. So first we will try to write down its structure. This should be like this. And this has negative charge. So this is your complex. It is first reacting with methyl iodide. So when it will react with methyl iodide, it will form. So how these reactions are happening, we will take it later in next chapter on the reaction mechanism of metal clusters. So it will form this complex. And in this complex, you have two different type of protons. This Cp has 5 protons and all the 5 protons are in the similar environment. We have seen it earlier and they will give you peak near 5 ppm. These 3 hydrogens are in different environment. They will give you peak around 2.5 to 3.5. So you have 2 different peaks. This peak is due to 5 hydrogens and this peak is due to 3 hydrogens. The ratio of intensity is 3:5. So it matches with our answer, means A should have a structure like this. Then we are reacting A with PPH3. So you will get B. So this reaction is basically migration insertion reaction. So we will take the detailed mechanism of this reaction in later videos. So you will get a product like this. Now you can find out 3 different type of proton. It will give you single peak due to 5 hydrogens. It will give you one peak due to 3 hydrogens. And it will give you one peak due to 15 hydrogens. 5 hydrogen in each pH. So you will get 15 peaks due to 15 hydrogens. So the peak intensity will be in the ratio of 3:5:15. So this will be your compound B. And this is A. Next question is from December 2017. The question is, assuming coupling for pH is greater than JPB, means coupling for PB, expected phosphorus 31 NMR spectrum of this adjunct H3PBCl3, where B is also IR active, 3:3, and its I is 3:2. Then you have to find out the expected spectrum. So for this phosphorus, the coupling is stronger with hydrogen. So you have only one phosphorus. So first you will get one peak, suppose, due to one phosphorus. Now this phosphorus peak will be splitted due to these three protons first, because its coupling is stronger with hydrogen. So it will be splitted due to these three hydrogens. So to find out splitting, we will use formula 2Ni plus 1, 2 into 3, because we have 3 hydrogens, into 1 by 2 plus 1. So your peak, single peak, will be splitted into 4 peaks, and the intensity ratio will be 1:3:3:1. Okay, because we have 3 protons here and their spins are 1 by 2, and if you know how they are interacting and this peak is splitting, then it is very easy to understand. Then next coupling is with this boron, which is also IR, which is also NMR active, but its nuclear spin is 3 by 2. So it is very important point here. You have only one boron and its I value is 3 by 2. So these four peaks will be splitted by one boron, and you will get that these four peaks will further splitted into four. Next question comes, what will be their intensity ratio? They will be splitted into same intensity because you have only one boron nuclei. Only one boron nuclei is interacting. Its I value is 3 by 2, but nuclei is only one. So each peak will be splitted into four peaks, but their intensity will be same. Like this. So your answer will be in which all the peaks have same intensity and each peak is splitted into four peaks. So answer 3 will be correct answer. Next we have question from December 2016. The question is, treatment of FeCO5 with 1,3-butadiene gives B that shows two signals in its proton NMR spectrum. B on treatment with HCl yields C, which shows four signals in proton NMR. Find out what is C. So first we have FeCO5 and it is reacting with 1,3-butadiene. So we can write 1,3-butadiene like this. Okay, so it will interact like this. So we will remove 2CO, because 1CO provide 2 electrons and this ligand will provide 4 electrons. So this is a substitution reaction. So we have a structure like this. This is your B. Now check that it is giving 2 signals in proton NMR. So we have 4 hydrogens on this butadiene. Suppose this one, this one, this one and this one. So these two are in same chemical environment because they are interacting with metal. So these two are of same type and these two are of same type. They are away from metal, but they are in same environment. So we have two peaks due to these two different proton groups. Now this is reacting with HCl. So when it will react with HCl, it will have a structure like this. That we have Cl here, CO here, and 1H will reduce this CH2 into CH3. So we have a structure like this. It will become CH2 double bond CH, single bond CH, double bond CH3. So it should have a structure like this. Okay, now we will check its proton NMR peaks. So these three hydrogens, here we have CH3, so they are entirely in different environment. These two are in different environment, so they have different peaks, and this one is different, so we have four peaks here. So your answer will be this one, and the mechanism of this, not this one, your answer will be this one. So we will see the mechanism of these reactions in next videos. So how they are reacting. Next we have question from June 2016. The proton NMR of this complex at 23 degree centigrade consists of a sharp single line. The number of signals observed at low temperature in its spectrum is. So this is an example of ring busy. So this complex should be like this. This ruthenium is associated with. So this complex should be like this. We have these protons attached here. So if you are recording this NMR at room temperature, then all these hydrogens can exchange their position due to ring busying. But if you are recording at low temperature, then these two hydrogen will be of same type because they are in chemically same environment. These two are of same type. These two are of same type and these two are of same type. So you will get four different peaks. Okay, we have four different type of protons here, so you will get four peaks. So option C will be your correct answer. Then the number of lines shown by BH3 part of molecule PH3P BH3 in proton and B NMR spectra are respectively. So we will first find out using proton NMR. So if we are considering proton NMR, then we have one peak due to protons, three protons. Now this peak will be split into this phosphorus and boron. So now it is interacting with two different type of nuclei. So we will use this formula 2Ni plus 1, 2Mi plus 1. So first we are taking suppose boron. So 2 into 1 because we have 1 boron, 3 by 2 plus 1. So we have 4 here and 2m is 1, 1 by 2 for phosphorus and we have 2 here. So 4 into 2, 8. So in proton NMR we have 8 peaks. Now we are using BNMR. So one peak due to one boron. Now it will be split due to phosphorus and three hydrogens. So we will take this formula 2N first phosphorus into 1 by 2 plus 1. And next we have hydrogens. So we have three hydrogens. So it will be again 8. So you will get 8 and 8 peaks. So your answer will be A. So this is the right option. This is all about NMR studies in metal clusters.